Committee will please come to order. I could ask everyone to take their seats and cease conversation. I want to thank the members who are here and encourage the members who aren't here to get here. This is the last of the leftover business that this committee has from the last Congress and the last administration. As you know, the previous administration financed the war on the installment plan by sending down a series of supplementals rather than including the funding in the base bill. This administration has indicated they intend to revert to regular order. And so if that's the case, this is the last of the cleanup jobs that we will have to do before we turn to next year's regular business. The product before the committee today represents funding for the rest of the fiscal year for the war in Iraq. It also contains the Obama administration requests for funding in for activities in Afghanistan and enhanced operations to shore up Pakistan in its struggle against the Taliban and al-Qaeda. It reflects other urgent appropriation needs as well. And I think at the outset, I just want to say one thing. Contrary to what some stories that I've seen have said, there are no timelines in this bill. There are no deadlines in this bill. There are no ultimatums in this bill. And there is no fight with the administration. The administration supports the bill that we are producing today. This is not a rubber stamp of administration policies. There are some significant changes, but there has been a cooperative decision-making effort in putting the bill together. And as a result, this bill is fairly close to the administration's requested package. It contains $94.2 billion, which is $9.3 billion above the request for DOD. It contains $78.4 billion, which is $4.7 billion above the request. In military construction, we are a billion above the administration request, largely for health care facilities. For pandemic flu, we are $500 million above the administration request. And with respect to various hardware items, largely the airplanes, there has been a compromise struck between the administration on C-17, C-130s, and tankers, which Mr. Murtha will expand on in more detail. And this bill also contains additional funding for items such as MRAPs, and it does something on stop loss, which should have been done a long time ago and would have been done a long time ago had our subcommittee had its way. With respect to Afghanistan and Pakistan, this bill reflects President Obama's intention to wind down the war in Iraq and shore up our efforts in Afghanistan and stabilize Pakistan. Let me be very frank with the committee. I personally am extremely dubious about the viability of any policy in that region of the world, not because I find particular fault with the administration's policies. I think that they are trying to construct a rational approach to the region. I simply am skeptical because with my long experience, I find it difficult to believe that there are many tools available for any administration to reach a favorable outcome in Afghanistan or Pakistan. I hope I'm wrong. But even though I am dubious, I have a responsibility to do more than simply reflect my own personal views because of my chairmanship of this committee. And so here's where I come out. And this bill, I think, reflects that as well as the concerns of a number of others. When I came to this town, it was 1969. Richard Nixon had just walked into the White House, and I was strongly opposed to the Vietnam War. And I was troubled about how to express that because my predecessor was a good friend, Mel Laird, who became Nixon's Secretary of Defense. And while I was opposed to the war from the get-go, President Nixon correctly pointed out that he had inherited that war from Johnson and that he thought he had the right to some period of time to show whether he could move policy forward or not. And so very reluctantly, I decided that I would keep my mouth shut for a year and give him a chance to move the policy. At the end of that year, that policy had not moved significantly, and so I began to vote regularly for efforts to end the war. I've reached roughly the same conclusion in this case. While I am very skeptical that Pakistan and the government of Afghanistan will demonstrate the kind of determination and behavior necessary to have a successful outcome, I think that President Obama, or I think that there is a consensus in the Congress to give President Obama time to demonstrate whether he can move that situation forward. And so what we do in this bill essentially is to give the president, give the administration everything they've asked for in this region and then some. In fact, we accelerate the delivery of some economic as well as some military aid to Pakistan, and we accelerate the delivery of State Department and civilian personnel into Afghanistan, and I think that if we're going to give the president a shot at it, we need to make certain that he has all the possible tools to succeed. But at the same time, I think we have an obligation to go into this with our eyes open in terms of what the realities are. And so I would simply like to read to the committee what I consider to be the key provision in this bill. It reads as follows. Because the stability and security of the region is tied more to the capacity and conduct of the Afghan and Pakistani governments and to the resolve of both societies than it is to the policies of the United States, the President shall submit a report to Congress not later than the date of submission of the fiscal year 2011 budget request, assessing whether the governments of Afghanistan and Pakistan are or are not demonstrating the necessary commitment, capability, conduct, and unity of purpose to warrant the continuation of the President's policy announced on March 27. The President, on the basis of information gathered and coordinated by the NSC, shall advise the Congress on how that assessment requires or does not require changes to that policy. The measures used to evaluate the Afghan and Pakistani government's record of concrete performance shall include the following standards of performance. Number one, level of political consensus and unity of purpose across ethnic, tribal, religious, and party affiliations to confront the political and security challenges facing the region. Two, level of government corruption and actions taken to eliminate it. Three, performance of the respective security forces in developing a counterinsurgency capability, conducting counterinsurgency operations, and establishing population security. 4, performance of the respective intelligence agencies in cooperating with the United States on counterinsurgency and counterterrorism operations, and in purging themselves of policies, programs, and personnel that provide material support to extremist networks that target U.S. troops or undermine U.S. objectives in the region. And 5, the ability of the Afghan and Pakistani governments to effectively control the territory within their respective borders. And very simply, the administration will have to provide that report to the Congress, and then each and every member of Congress at that time will have to assess the accuracy of the administration's evaluation, and they'll have to assess for themselves whether they think the situation and the progress or lack thereof in the region justifies continued following of the administration policy. That's what it does. These are not conditions, as I said. These are not timelines. It is simply a requirement for a hard-nosed, and I would hope, fisher-cut-bait evaluation, but it's up to the administration, and it's up to the Congress to evaluate the administration's report at that time. As I say, I remain skeptical, but I hope to be proven wrong. The other thing I want to mention is that this bill also includes $500 million above the administration for dealing with pandemic flu. We've had a troubled history on this issue. The Bush administration asked the Congress in 2005 for a $7 billion level of funding to put us in a much stronger position to deal with potential pandemics in the future. The Congress did not fully respond to that request. It provided a one-third of the request the first year. It provided a second tranche the second year. And it has provided some dribs and drabs since then, but still has not fully met the Bush administration request for funding. We have added $200 million to President Obama's request in order to try to beef up international aspects of our efforts to know what's going on with respect to this threat worldwide. And secondly, we add an additional $350 million to the administration's request to beef up our capacity to respond at the state and local level. Some states, for instance, have very little by way of antivirals on hand. My own state has only 7% of what is estimated to be needed to deal with the problem. We have had over 11,000 layoffs in the public health sector over the past year and a half at the state and local level. Those layoffs do not help us prepare for what could be a very serious situation. We do not know if the existing H1N1 virus is in fact going to prove to be serious or not. So far, we think there are some encouraging signs. But people felt the same way in 1918 when the first round of that flu hit, and then it turned vicious and virulent, and 50 million people died around the country. So this is nothing to fool around with. This committee did have some additional funds in the stimulus package to try to beef up our effort. Those were stripped because of Senate demands during the conference. And now we're back with that same request and then some because of the changed circumstances. I would urge support for the package with all of my doubts about the effort in Pakistan and Afghanistan. And at this point, I'd ask Mr. Lewis for any comments he might like to make.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I'm especially thrilled at the prospect of our being back in the full appropriations committee room again. In fact, it has been so long since we've been together and so long since I've been able to go to the fitness facility, I'm afraid that my buddy Jesse's effort to keep himself in shape, if he goes any further, he's going to disappear on us. You're getting mighty thin, Jess. I am very hopeful that today's markup signals a return to our traditional committee process, including amendments and open debate. That has long been the style and approach of this committee. I mean, I'm absolutely convinced that at the subcommittee level, where Democrats and Republicans can come together and chew on issues and pros and cons and tap into the talent of their staffs as well, is where we develop the best process whereby the Appropriations Committee delivers products that everybody can be proud of. So I'm anxious to see us return to that pattern, and I must say that the series of subcommittee hearings that have been taking place this year is most encouraging that we're moving in the right direction. I don't know a member in this committee who would object to our returning to regular order, and we know full well we can get our work done on time and done well if we work in that fashion together. I'm also moved to say that we welcome the idea of ending the practice of designating emergency spending to fund many non-emergency programs and returning to an honest and open and transparent process. The chairman's commentary about the flu circumstance are very appropriate. We have emergencies that require special attention, and clearly that is one of them. I'm also very pleased that this package represents a positive step forward in allowing the commander-in-chief to do his job without Congress imposing arbitrary lines or requirements. We will be having a discussion in a while, I believe, on one of the amendments relative to one of those ways in which we have chosen to impose ourselves on the Commander-in-Chief's direction. But that's for a later discussion. Committee members were initially led to believe that this legislation would be kept at the President's request level of $84 billion to fund only the critical needs of the global war on terrorism. As presented today, the legislation has grown by 11% to $94 billion since it was submitted to the Congress. I think the chairman has pretty much laid the foundation for understanding how we got there and having that discussion further. While some additional spending has been added, the defense portion of this package, as a result of bipartisan coordination between Mr. Murtha and Mr. Young, a few of my friends in the majority have added billions of dollars on international assistance programs that will be the subject of that discussion I referred to. At the same time, for any concerns I may have about this legislation as written, we have the opportunity to improve it today through the process of discussion and amendment. And I would hope that we would address these potential changes with that spirit that I referred to in my initial remarks. The members know that we face many crises around the world that deserve our attention. It was President Kennedy who a generation ago reminded us that when written in Chinese, the word crises is composed of two characters. One represents danger, the other represents opportunity. If there is any doubt about what we're doing, let us all be mindful that this supplemental provides the necessary resources for our soldiers and civilians who are waging a war on terrorism, and we wish them success, particularly in Iraq, Afghanistan, and Pakistan. We know that the Taliban is now increasingly emboldened, and the situation on the ground in Pakistan is, at best, fragile. The situation is now the most urgent foreign policy crisis facing the Commander-in-Chief, our President, and the Congress. Close to our shores, the potential closure of Guantanamo has become a symbol of the best intentions colliding head-on, with policy and political reality. I applaud Chairman Obie's decision for the wisdom of President Obie to withhold those funds relative to closing Guantanamo. Did I say President Obie? Well, every once in a while, I wonder. One of our members just twittered that. You've got to be very careful. It really is very important, as we looked at look at problems closer to our shore, that we be very, very careful about what happens with Guantanamo. I have for discussion later, perhaps, a listing with some description of the 10 most serious terrorists who are located at Guantanamo. To have people like that, and we don't know the intentions of all those numbers, but to have people like that released into civilian communities is absolutely not acceptable. So I look forward, very much look forward, to the President's plan before we go forward with a decision that some believe is unchangeable. As we move beyond the full committee to the House floor next week, it's my hope that the majority leadership will allow our process to proceed without exerting extraordinary undue influence. Our appropriations process works best, as I've suggested, when it is allowed to work in open and in a transparent fashion. In closing, I'd like to share a few words written about our friend, and by the way, a long-term member of this committee, Jack Kemp. The article I would refer to suggests, and I quote, he had the ability to come back at times of adversity to make things happen. He didn't shrink from anything. Every challenge he ever saw, he faced up to. Jack Kemp loved our country, as we all do, and he realized that the United States must always stand up to adversity, make the tough decisions, and do what is right and just. It is, for me at any rate, in this spirit that I urge our committee to work in a spirit of comity, placing the nation's security interests ahead of our own purely personal opinion or political interests. So with that, Mr. Chairman, I yield back to you.
I thank the gentleman. Let me simply say something with respect to Jack Kemp. Jack served on this committee with great distinction. He, in fact, for a significant period of time, was my ranking member when I chaired the Foreign Operations Subcommittee. And while I did not agree with everything that he said on the subject, he certainly was one of the first to point to the excesses of the IMF in the way they manhandled rather than managed third world countries who were in financial trouble. And I also want to say that every single member of this committee is able to function at a higher degree of effectiveness today, in part because of Jack. Because the system of associate staff on this committee. When I came on this committee, the committee had no associate staff. And I got together with Jack, and he and I co-sponsored the amendment to the committee rules that gave every member of the committee associate staff so that someone besides the chairman had an opportunity to know what was going on. In those days, even the public hearings held by this committee and subcommittee were behind closed doors. And so we were able to use our associate staff to at least be able to understand what the various committee chairmen were doing. That would not have happened without Jack's willingness to work across the aisle. He was a quarterback for the wrong football team, but outside of that, he was a good friend, and we're all sorry to see him go. Having said that, I would now like to proceed, unless there are any other comments from anyone, I'd like to proceed to the manager's amendment. Oh, I'm sorry. I'm getting ahead of myself. I need to ask the subcommittee chair and ranking members for their comments first, starting with Mr. Murtha.
The defense title of this bill provides funding to support overseas contingency operations in Afghanistan and Iraq. The bill includes a total of $78.4 billion in defense title, an increase of $4.9 billion above the request. The bill provides additional support for military personnel stop loss. I've been working with the Secretary about stop loss for about 3 years. First, when he first appeared before our committee, he said, I'm going to stop loss. There's actually more people on stop loss now than there were when he took over. And so we think they ought to be reimbursed because they were extended beyond their enlistment. And so we put $734 million in to take care of the ones that were extended beyond their enlistment. TBI and psychological health, we put an extra $100 million to develop alternative treatments, which have been, we see to be very effective. Orthopedic research. I just went through a replacement of a knee. I'm going to tell you something. I'm very much in favor of orthopedic research. This is a very painful thing. Includes $68 million for that. Amputee rehabilitation. The bill includes $20 million above the request to procure equipment for rehabilitation facilities at Bethesda in particular. Joint family assistance, the bill includes $125.1 million above the request, a total of $807 million for family advocacy programs such as child care, including special needs, counseling, family reintegration assistance, and spouse career training. One of the things I found when I was down at one of the bases, they said, you know, we got to have some counseling for the spouses. They said, we make all this money from overseas, and this is just one or two people. I come home, and there's no money left. I don't say that he said the spouse was spending the money, but it was a man that said that. So we're trying to work out a counseling for the spouses. Bill increased funding for key acquisition programs, airlift, $3.1 billion. Let me tell you, I wasn't in negotiations for this with the White House, but the chairman did a hell of a job, did everything he could to make sure we had additional C-17s and 130s. We also put in the bill $432 million for 24 AH-64 helicopters, A to D models. We put the bill includes $175 million above the budget request to replace combat losses. MRAPs, $4.8 billion for 1,800 lightweight MRAPs. Problem we have in Afghanistan, the bigger ones won't work. We got no roads. We don't even have a rail line in Afghanistan. So you need something to secure the troop strikers. Put $338 million above the request for 225 medical evacuation strikers. Now, one of the problems we have in Afghanistan, takes twice as long to get people to the hospital in Afghanistan than it does in Iraq. And, of course, that's a critical period of time. And we're doing everything we can to get them the helicopters and to get them the strikers they need. And these are the type of vehicles that would get people to the hospitals faster. Bradley fighting vehicles, $243 million. National Guard and Reserve equipment, $500 million. And Guantanamo, as Mr. Lewis said, what we did was take the money out and said, before you get the money, we want you to give us a plan. We put no permanent bases in Iraq, no permanent bases in Afghanistan. Training Afghanistan security forces, the bill includes $3.6 billion. The amount requested to train Afghanistan security forces. Contracting report includes language directing the Department of Defense to provide monthly reports on a number of contractors in CENTCOM. I've been on this issue ever since we started a new regime here, telling the administration over and over again, not only let's get the troops out, let's get the contractors out. And I still haven't seen a plan. But we've got actually more contractors in Iraq than we do U.S. military personnel. So we got some work to do yet, and this would force them to give us a report on that.
Mr. Chairman, thank you very much, and I rise to just mention briefly my support for, and the Republican members on the subcommittee support for, the defense part of this bill. As we have done for many, many years, Jack Murth and I have worked together to formulate a bill that is just good for the country. He's been my chairman twice, I've been his chairman twice, and when we produce a product, you can't tell the difference. The product is the product that we support. And I think proof of that is that we have on occasion passed a defense bill on the House in less than 10 minutes, which is a pretty good indication that we've had a good working relationship in providing for the security of the nation. There's not much more to say. Jack has explained the bill. You've had copies. The subcommittee members have all had specific information. And so we support, and this is the major part of the bill, we support this, and we thank Mr. Murtha and his staff for working so closely with me and our staff to make sure that this product was a bipartisan product, mainly for the good of the country and the good of our troops who serve the country. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Ms. Lowy. Is your mic on?
I'll thank you again. And thank Kay Granger and my ranking member and all the members of the subcommittee for your advice and suggestions. This legislation provides the resources our military, diplomatic, and development personnel need to make our nation more secure, particularly in Afghanistan, Pakistan, Iraq, and Mexico. The Obama administration's policy to defeat the Taliban and al-Qaeda in Afghanistan and Pakistan, to prevent the region from being a base for terrorist plots against the United States and allies, and our allies, is critical, although many questions do remain. This legislation provides $3.8 billion for military, diplomatic, and development initiatives in the region. I also support the chairman's decision to put funding and authority for the Pakistan Counterinsurgency Capability Fund under the State Foreign Operations section of the bill. The manager's amendment provides authority for the PCCF through the Department of Defense in fiscal year 2009, but continues the program under the authority of the Secretary of State in fiscal year 2010, which is consistent with the administration position and statements by Secretary Gates before the Senate Appropriations Committee last week. This fund will help Pakistani forces defeat militants within their own border and will ultimately be under the jurisdiction of the Secretary of State so that it can be implemented in the context of our overall foreign policy. I welcome the Obama administration's efforts to forge a lasting peace between Israel and the Palestinian Authority. This legislation provides economic, humanitarian, and security assistance for the West Bank and Gaza, which is necessary to encourage stability, self-sufficiency, and political moderation. It ensures that Hamas and other terrorist organizations do not receive taxpayer funding and that a potential unity government and all its ministers or equivalent publicly recognize Israel's right to exist, renounce violence, and adhere to past agreements. In order to counter the ambitions of Iran in the region and to reinforce our commitment to the security of our allies in the Middle East, the bill accelerates part of the security assistance for Jordan, Egypt, and for Israel that was requested in FY2010 pursuant to our MOUs and agreements with those countries. The legislation also provides $470 million to help Mexico fight violent narco traffickers with surveillance aircraft, helicopters, law enforcement equipment, and to support the rule of law programs, bringing to $1.17 billion the total appropriated in 2008-2009 for these purposes. The bill meets the President's request for assistance programs and for diplomatic operations in Iraq to ensure a smooth transition from the military mission to a civilian-led effort. In addition, the bill seeks to address significant humanitarian and development priorities by providing $50 million above the request for a total of $343 million in this bill for refugee programs in order to address the growing displacement of civilians not only in Pakistan and other countries, but all over the world. This is a tremendous, tremendous need which we have a moral obligation to address. $836.9 million for peacekeeping, $300 million for countries impacted by the global financial crisis, including Haiti and Liberia, and by providing $100 million for the Global Fund to Fight AIDS, Tuberculosis, and Malaria. So I look forward to swift enactment of this legislation so that our military, diplomatic, and defense personnel have access to the resources they need. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'll take just a minute. I want to express my appreciation as the ranking member of Foreign Operations for Chairman Lowy for her willingness to work together on this, and I look forward to working with you on the 2010 bill. It's very important funding for our military and our civilians in order for them to be successful in Iraq, Afghanistan, and Pakistan. Also, the assets for the Mexican government to fight the drug cartels in Mexico, exceptionally important. And we all know, we're very aware that this violence could and has been spilling over across our borders. And so we need the help on both sides for our borders for that. The $2 million for the pandemic flu preparedness through the labor age and state foreign operations chapters is most important, making sure that the funds in the pipeline at HHS are used to replenish our federal and state stockpiles of antivirals. And Chairman Obi, I'd like to work with you. I know that's been an interest of yours and a concern of yours for some time. It could take as long as 5 years, as you know, to develop the next generation of antivirals. This has been a wake-up call for us, and let's make sure we're prepared for the fall and for the next years. They are very important provisions. We all have concerns about Pakistan and what's happening there that's been mentioned here today, and making sure those assets and our funding is used most effectively is going to be very important. In closing, I thank you for the opportunity and look forward to working with you.
Chairman and members, the military construction part of this bill funds $3.2 billion to support our operations in Afghanistan, $900 million above the President's request, and in doing so makes a major commitment to improving quality of health care for our wounded warriors, particularly our most severely wounded warriors, and it improves the quality of life and health care for the people I consider to be the unsung heroes in our nation's defense, our military spouses, and our military children. Let me just mention four specific provisions in the bill. One, it provides funding to build seven new warrior transition complexes. Those healthcare and rehab facilities, as you know, are providing care for the most severely wounded, mentally and physically, of our troops. Secondly, it funds 25 child development centers. That has been for years the number one priority of our top enlisted officers who've said that while moms and dads are fighting in Iraq and Afghanistan, the remaining spouses deserve back home, particularly those who have jobs, to have children, their children have access to quality, safe, affordable health care. Thirdly, we provide and take the initiative to provide $1 billion to modernize our DoD health care system. All of us sadly remember the conditions at Walter Reed Annex 18. None of us wants to see a repeat of that. And with this $1 billion, our subcommittee and this committee, all of us together, will have provided $3.3 billion in the last 12 months the modernization of the DoD healthcare. That is equivalent to the investment made in the last 25 years prior to that for modernizing our DoD hospitals. And finally, we provide $214 million more than the administration asked provide housing, better temporary housing for our troops in Afghanistan. Finally, I want to thank Mr. Womp. Our ranking member could not be here today because of family obligations, but Zach has always been there in our subcommittee when it has come to working together on a bipartisan basis to support our troops, their health care, and their quality of life. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I simply want to echo the the words of our chairman and thank him for his hard work. I think in particular with these increased deployments, it puts so much strain not only on our troops, on the sailors, on the equipment, on the operational facilities, but as he pointed out, it puts a tremendous amount of strain on families. And this has truly been a bipartisan effort, particularly in the areas of quality of life, so that when the moms and dads are gone on deployment, that the families back home don't have to carry so much additional strain all on their own. So thank you for your leadership, Mr. Chairman. We applaud the work. It's truly been a bipartisan effort between all the members of the committee. I yield back my time.
Mr. Rogers.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I know we're here today primarily on the resources necessary to support the troops and our mission in Iraq and Afghanistan, and toward that end, you have my support. I have to cite a strong objection, however, to the inclusion in the bill and other parts of the bill, which constitute, in my judgment, an enormous federal overstep, and the exclusion of funding to address the very real drug war raging along our southwest border and all across this country because of that, that DHS and the Department of Justice and others are dealing with every day. Let me talk briefly, quickly about SAFER, which is a grant program for firefighters. For years, I've supported, and you've supported, a grant program to help local fire departments hire new personnel. We put a lot of qualifications on that. We said, you've got to come up locally with 25%. And it was a good grant program, still is. However, in this bill, we are going way beyond that, and I want you just to think about the possible consequences of what we're doing here. One, in the stimulus bill, we did away with that local requirement. There no longer is a 25% local match required. So it's 100% federal grant now by the stimulus bill. In this bill, we're taking away the limitation that the monies could only be used for new firefighting personnel. In this bill, we're saying to local communities, we'll pick up 100% of your existing personnel. And while we are all big supporters of firefighters and their wonderful civic servants, I just want you to think about the fiscal step that we're taking in this bill. Now, second and most importantly, the omission of funding in the bill to fight the Mexican drug war, the war on the Mexican border, encroaching onto our side of the border every day, is a bit alarming to me, and I think bespeaks a gross misplacement of priorities. We find over $3 billion in this bill in unrequested priorities for foreign assistance, and we find nothing in this bill to beef up the resources on our side of that border to fight the to wage the counter-narcotics and law enforcement operations here at home. Now, there's substantial funding to help Mexico in the bill, and there is $350 million that is, quote, coded, quote, as being for counter-narcotics and border security. But don't be fooled. Not one dime of those billions of dollars provided by this bill will go to the DEA, to the Coast Guard, to the Border Patrol, to ICE, U.S. attorneys, FBI, marshals, ATF, or local law enforcement. Not a dime in this bill for that war. So there's a lot of talk about getting serious in combating the threat posed by narco-terrorism. But so far, we've only heard talk. We've seen no action. Action in the form of real dollars to address a real problem. Mr. Chairman, emergency bills are about getting our priorities right. Neither the federalizing of local fire departments nor neglecting the treacherous drug war on our doorsteps are, quote, priorities that I can support. We've got to do better, and I think some of us here will have more to say about this a little later in the day. So I invite your continued attention. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, I would like briefly to respond to our distinguished ranking member's points. We will have the chance, I think, in the context of an amendment I understand he'll be offering to discuss the matter of fortifying border security. But I want to respond very briefly and I think concisely, because it's not a complicated point, to the provision in this bill having to do with SAFER, which is the firefighter grants. We have included language to enable our fire departments under these extraordinary economic circumstances on a temporary basis to utilize these funds to avoid layoffs and to stabilize their fire departments as well as to hire new firefighters. Obviously, most of the time under normal circumstances, this SAFER money would be used to hire and train new firefighters. That's the purpose of the program, and nothing in this bill changes that. But we do have these temporary provisions. If a fire department is faced with laying off personnel, then to come in with the normal maintenance of effort requirements and a requirement that money can be spent only for new personnel, obviously, is counterproductive. Moreover, what we're doing here is no more, no less than we have already done with respect to law enforcement and the COPS program. No special treatment, no special provisions. It's simply a matter of equity with respect to the treatment given law enforcement previous to this and the treatment in this bill that we're giving to the firefighters. So I'd like to assure colleagues there's no nothing extraordinary here. This is a temporary provision dictated by our economic circumstances. Does not change the fundamental character of the SAFER program.
Mr. Chairman, I just wanted to report that in the supplemental, we have a very modest amount of money, $250 million to suppress wildfires, $200 million for the Forest Service, and $50 million for the Department of Interior. This is one of our most difficult issues in our bill because it's very hard to predict what the level of these fires will be. And so I think adding this money is a good idea. We don't have enough money in the regular budget. And in the Forest Service, what they do is they go to other accounts in the Forest Service, roads, timber production, woody biomass. They take the money out of those accounts to fight the fires, and sometimes they get paid back and sometimes they don't. So I think the administration is doing the right thing by requesting this money, and I appreciate the chairman putting it in the supplemental. If my colleague, Mike Simpson, would like to, I'd yield to him just for.
Well, I thank the chairman for. Used to be that about 13% of the Forest Service budget went to fighting fires. Today it's upwards of 48 or 49% of their budget. And in order to fight these catastrophic wildfires that are happening, particularly in the West, but throughout the country, really, we are devastating the other accounts, and the Forest Service isn't able to do their job in some of the other areas. And so putting this money in there and trying to raise that level so that it doesn't destroy the rest of the Forest Service accounts, such as thinning and those types of things and fire preparedness around communities is an important thing. So I thank the chairman for working with us to make sure that that gets in there. I'm going to yield back.
Well, the comments, the chair has a manager's amendment, which has been cleared on both sides. I ask unanimous consent to suspend with the reading, and I'll briefly explain it. This amendment, as I say, has been cleared by both sides of the aisle. It shifts $100 million for additional Army radios to P-3 aircraft wing kits. It provides an extra 71, my notes say billion, but it's million. It provides an additional $71 million for direct and guaranteed farm ownership loans and offsets that increase with a reduction in the rural development mission area there are 47 states who are facing backlogs because of the economic situation. It corrects a few clerical errors, one of them being on the stop-loss payment date. It requires Secretary of State to report within 120 days on the establishment of a Palestinian power-sharing government and every quarter thereafter that such government and its ministers are complying with the law. It adds additional requirements in bill language on the United Nations Relief and Work Agency Accountability Report. It adds support language on combat uniforms, on the DOD Vision Center for Excellence and F-18 aircraft. It clarifies expectations regarding the use of funds, including the expectation that no assistance provided to Mexico should be used to repress political opposition. It adds report language directing USAID to include transportation infrastructure projects in the economic development program in Pakistan. Mr. Lewis.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. There is a slight disagreement here between the chairman and myself. I'm not sure that there's a disagreement at all. All of us know the very, very difficult circumstance in Pakistan.
This is just the manager's amendment.
I'm very sorry. I want to get to disagreement immediately. Actually, the chairman.
That's all right. We both screwed up once this morning.
Yeah,
we're even.
Yeah. The chairman suddenly caught me off guard because when we agree on things, I mean, we hardly have a discussion. And when we disagree, we have no discussion. The manager's amendment covers a number of issues that are very important to us, and both sides support it.
There we are, back on track. On the manager's amendment, Mr. Kirk.
Mr. Chairman, the manager's amendment clarifies a surprising decision by the administration to reverse language which Chairwoman Lowy wrote, prohibiting assistance to a Hamas government. We have $815 million proposed, and I think what the chairwoman and I have done is dramatically tighten up the language from what Secretary Clinton surprisingly proposed. Originally, her proposal was that taxpayer subsidies could go to a Hamas coalition government only if the prime minister said he was good with the peace process and the existence of Israel. We have now tightened that up to also require ministers and a reporting requirement and to make this commitment public in writing. And so I want to thank her for that. I really hope, though, that this idea of taxpayer subsidies to a Hamas coalition government is an idea whose time should never come, since Hamas is responsible for the murder of 26 American citizens. I would also pay special note that if we ever find one of the Hamas killers, murderers, of an American citizen, either as a minister of the coalition government or as a staffer, that we would be able to have the guts at least to terminate taxpayer assistance to that ministry until that person was terminated, first off. Secondly, the chairwoman has very graciously funded the Pashto service, which is the main language group of where our armed forces are deployed, in southern and eastern Afghanistan. But the problem that we found is, while this very needed transmission is happening, the staff has taken upon themselves to put public enemy number three in the region, Batula Massoud, on the radio, giving him a taxpayer-subsidized platform. And ironically, this was only 2 weeks after the United States put out a $5 million reward for his arrest or capture. And so I'm very pleased that we're launching an investigation of that, but still supporting the very needed Pashto service. And finally, we were very concerned about initial reports, given the growing threat from Iran, that the administration had proposed a number of cuts to the missile defense of the United States and of Israel. The initial indications given to the government of Israel were that funding for the upgrade of the Israeli anti-missile system called Arrow 3 would not be provided. We now understand, thanks to Chairman Murtha, that the Obama administration plan to cut Arrow 3 has now been reversed, and that we are going to be providing $30 million for Arrow 3 just in time for the Netanyahu-Obama summit. And so I want to thank you and thank the chairwoman because I very strongly support the manager's amendment.
Mr. Chairman, I just want to briefly respond, and I am pleased that Mr. Kirk, Mr. Rothman, Mr. Israel, Mr. Schiff, other members of our subcommittee were very helpful in drafting language to respond to Senator Mitchell and, frankly, the President of the United States' initiative to try and bring about peace. We know that it's going to be very difficult to be able to construct, whether you call it a power-sharing government or a unity government. In fact, in many of our discussions with Senator Mitchell, it was clear that this was a hypothetical. But there was general agreement in the subcommittee that we have a responsibility to work with a president who is committed to trying to forge a peace agreement in the region, and to work with Senator Mitchell, the envoy, who is committed to forge a peace agreement in the region. We all know the obstacles. It is very, very difficult. We know that. But I am very grateful that with the support and suggestions and advice of our subcommittee, we've been able to craft language to build on their requests. So we put in place appropriate safeguards. We all agree that no money should go to Hamas. This is clear. But we also believe that if there is a government that is committed to try and work together in unity, as difficult as that may be, we wanted to ensure that every minister or the equivalent who would be part of that government would publicly declare their support for the existence of the state of Israel, for PATO, which is legislation that passed this Congress. So I appreciate you bringing it up, and I personally want to thank all the members of our committee. We know the challenges are great, but hopefully in our lifetime, despite all the tremendous challenges, we will see peace in that region. Thank you.
Two brief comments. First, I'd like to thank the chair and the full committee and the chair of our subcommittee for working with so many of us in working on this language that my distinguished colleague from Illinois, Mr. Kirk, referred to. I would characterize the nature of the government that was spoken about a little differently. This would not be a Hamas unity government. The goal that some have suggested might assist in the peace process is a Palestinian unity government. When we heard about this, a number of us immediately wanted to make certain that anyone who would participate in such a Palestinian unity government would first, if they were going to receive one penny or more of U.S. taxpayer dollars, first accept the principle that Israel should continue to exist and has the right to exist forever, that they would accept all of the quartet principles and previous agreements negotiated between the Israelis and Palestinians, and that they would resolve all of their other outstanding issues without violence. And under those circumstances, if they would do so publicly, each and every part, each and every minister and counterpart in that government, then we could accept that idea to give Senator Mitchell the flexibility he asked for. I also want to thank the Obama administration because from the very beginning, they were genuinely open and helpful to in shaping the language that presently exists. I do also want to thank my colleagues who assisted that process as well, as Mrs. Lowy pointed out. The second item is a thank you to my distinguished chairman, Mr. Murtha. I have been working on Mr. Murtha's subcommittee on defense now for several years, and he has consistently, and our committee has consistently supported the Arrow Anti-Ballistic Missile 3 program, which is a joint program between the State of Israel and the United States to develop an anti-ballistic missile capability, and it's doing very well. It was plussed up last year, and we were certain that it would be plussed up this year, and I had no doubt about it. So I want to thank the chair for continuing his support of that program, and look forward to seeing it as we all expected in the 2010 defense bill. Thank you.
This is the amendment that Jerry was talking about when he was suggesting that we might have a slight disagreement. Basically, the situation is that we have had a counterinsurgency capability fund in Iraq for quite some time, and that funding has run directly to and through the Defense Department. The administration requested that we provide a similar arrangement with respect to Pakistan. The bill before you now, without this amendment, makes one change in the administration's request. It directs that the money go to the Secretary of State rather than the Secretary of Defense with an immediate pass-through to the Defense Department. The Defense Department will manage this money under any arrangement, but you have the question of whether or not in dealing with the civilian government in Pakistan, where we are trying to emphasize to the military the primacy of civilian leadership. You have a question of whether or not the civilian leadership of the Pakistan government should be cut out of the process, as well as having the civilian leadership on the part of the United States also take a secondary role. We felt very strongly that that should not be the case, that the primacy of the Secretary of State should be recognized, even though it's obvious that the program will require a pass-through of that money immediately to defense. So we provided that the money immediately go to the Secretary of State. In testimony before the Armed Services Committee, Secretary Gates suggested the possibility of a compromise. And Admiral Mullen called me and asked if I would consider the same thing. And that's what this amendment does. So instead of providing $400 million to the State Department directly initially the first year and $950 million in economic support funds, including $500 million of forward-funded economic support funds, instead of doing that, we are in this amendment doing what Secretary Gates suggested as a compromise, which is to provide $400 million for military training and $100 million for ESF. And what would happen is that for the first year, this money would go directly to the Defense Department so that you can have an orderly transition. But in the second year, the authority will pass to the Secretary of State, again, with the requirement that it be passed through to the Defense Department. Another reason for the distinction is that in Iraq, you have a situation where we have troops on the ground, boots on the ground, and therefore may make sense to provide this funds initially to the Department of Defense. But in Pakistan, we do not have boots on the ground. We're hoping to avoid having boots on the ground. And we think, therefore, that in Pakistan, it's constructive to recognize the primacy of the Secretary of State and to effect a compromise between the agencies so that both agencies know what the lay of the land is and they don't spend the next year trying to reposition themselves against each other. We simply take the Gates proposal and provide the first year funding directly to the Defense Department, and then we have an orderly transfer to the State Department the second year, and I would urge support for the amendment. Mr. Lewis.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. This is the place where there is what appears to be a slight disagreement, and I'm only raising this question because I find myself in a very unusual position of supporting the administration's position, that which they suggest we should do with this money, and we want to shift that a little bit in the second year. And there are several reasons why I feel it's very, very important that we perfect the chairman's proposal by making sure that we follow the direction of the administration as they outlined it. The fund we're talking about is really money that would flow to training and supplying, but retraining troops in the region. Presently, funds like this, operating in both Afghanistan and Iraq, are presently controlled by the military. That is the policy the administration has supported, and they are suggesting we follow exactly that policy in this instance. I've had conversations, and we've had communication from Admiral Mullen, from General Petraeus, from Secretary Gates. All of them believe that this PCCF should be controlled by the Department of Defense. I feel it's important that we follow their policy for any number of added reasons, for we all should have some very special concerns about the military and the way it has operated in Pakistan. Since Pakistan developed a nuclear weapon, and since they have a first strike policy vis-a-vis India, we're dealing in an environment that is extremely dangerous. Since that nuclear policy developed, Pakistan's military has not participated in what is known as IMET. IMET is the International Military Education and Training Program, a fabulous program developed over the years whereby we bring military leaders of countries around the world into essentially our good offices and give them counsel, direction, training, etc. It has moderated military leadership and improved the quality of that leadership in countries all over the world. It seems to me that it's very important to know that in areas outside of their own direct expertise, the State Department doesn't always do such a good job. And they certainly stumbled around in terms of delivering even economic money in Pakistan. So I would suggest that we ought to perfect this by way of saying that these monies will flow as the administration suggested it. And I'll have an amendment to perfect following this discussion. It's really important for us to know that the military leadership in Pakistan and our leadership do communicate very positively with each other. But I believe they would benefit greatly from us bringing them further down the pathway and have them participate in IMET. I'm not sure that the State Department over this next couple of years period is the place to get that done. So all I'm suggesting is the administration, Gates, Petraeus, the chairman of the Joint Chief, all think this money ought to remain in the military. It's a minor change, and I'd urge the body to consider that change. We'll have plenty of time between now and the time we go to the O-10 process to see if things are in much worse condition than I anticipate in connection with this prospect. But why make the change now? I frankly would urge the body to recognize that the leadership within the administration, the commander-in-chief, is asking us to follow the pattern we followed in both Afghanistan and Iraq, and I urge us to do the same.
Well, if I can... Ms. Lowy.
Mr. Chairman and my colleagues, I rise in strong support of Chairman Obie's amendment. I have to be honest and say to you that the chairman's original mark that provided the funding straight to the State Department for the PCCF in FY2009 is something I supported. I strongly believe that this program should be housed in the State Department from the very start, so there is no ambiguity on the primacy of the Secretary of State in setting U.S. foreign policy, and particularly in overseeing the policy in Pakistan and our relationship with that government. First of all, the underlying responsibility and authority for providing military assistance, including training and equipment for counterinsurgency and counterterrorism purposes, rests with the Secretary of State. It's only been where the United States has combat troops on the ground. I want to make this very clear. In Afghanistan, where there are combat troops on the ground, the money goes directly to the Defense Department. The authorities go to the State Department when we do not have troops on the ground. In Pakistan, it's very clear that the authority should remain with the Secretary of State. We have an outstanding leader in Secretary Clinton. Ambassador Holbrooke is one of the ablest diplomats in the country. Ambassador Patterson is in Islamabad, is working every day, every hour, to preserve our interests and advance our goals. We need to make sure that our diplomatic tools are fortified, that they have all the tools they need in terms of policy. Now, the security assistance is a very critical component of our strategy with Pakistan. And that's why it should be under the foreign policy control of the Secretary of State. Secretary Gates has said that he and Secretary Clinton have agreed that if Congress provides the funds directly to DOD for the FY2009 supplemental, they are in agreement on the funds being provided through state and FY2010 budget. And that is exactly what Chairman Obie wants to do, and I respect that agreement. Chairman Obie worked with Jack Murtha, worked with myself, worked with Ike Skelton, worked with Howard Berman to reach this compromise. So again, I just want to make it very clear. Traditionally, although it's the Defense Department that carries out these efforts, the money where there are no boots on the ground has gone to the State Department, which then passes it through to the Department of Defense. You don't want to eliminate a Secretary of State who has the responsibility for making this policy. You don't want to eliminate her input into this decision. In terms of crafting the compromise, it was made very clear that it would move through, it wouldn't delay anything. And again, this training goes to the police, it goes to the constabulary, it goes to the frontier corps, it goes to the militias, and the Defense Department will do that training. So I just wanted to make it clear that I am pleased that we were able to work with Jack Murtha, Ike Skelton, Howard Berman, and Chairman Obie in crafting this compromise, and I strongly feel that we should be supporting it with great respect to our good friend, Mr. Lewis.
Thank you, Ms. Chairman. I want to rise on this amendment because I want to give you a little background. What we've done in this committee and other committees, listening to all the combatant commanders who tell us that we can get into these countries, but we can't get out. The solution is not going to be a military solution. It's going to have to be a civilian solution. Up until last year, we never had the ability to deploy that civilian solution. And as you think about it, when the military is there, it's all under a unified command. When you're trying to do the post-conflict, you have all the NGOs, you have international governments coming in. Nobody has cross-trained or had. So we set up last year, and I carried the bill along with Mr. Saxton and Mr. Lugar and Mr. Biden last year to create in the State Department a Center for Post-Conflict Reconstruction and Stabilization. And the idea was to go out and take the people out of civilian service that are in the State Department, USAID, backing up with other federal
folks, U.S. Department of Agriculture, and all the other federal family in creating what we called a civilian response corps, crisis corps. And the military, in fact, General Petraeus in this room just 2 weeks ago, was asking our committee to fully fund that effort. That effort is in the State Department. And it's a need that the military has, but it's a civilian responsibility. So there are these crossovers, and I think Mr. Lewis is absolutely right on the extended IMAT. The problem with IMAT, which is a military education program, is it's funded out of the State Department. That one I think we ought to take back and ought to be out of the Defense Department. But there are these sort of new responsibilities, new authorities that we've created that we haven't funded before. And so the question is, where does the money come from? And I think it's very important that if we're going to stabilize and be able to bring in the talent to bring that to make that stability, that we're going to have to find the resources to do it. And we haven't done it in the budget for the State Department. So I support Mr. Obie's amendment.
I'm going to try to get the vote in on this amendment before we leave for the vote. Did you want 2 minutes to close?
I frankly want to know whether you want me to offer my perfecting amendment now or wait till we get back.
Oh, why don't you do it now? I thought you had.
No, I've explained it, but I have not submitted it.
Okay, then why doesn't the gentleman offer the amendment now?
I'll do that. The amendment, by way of a perfection of that which the chairman is proposing, would place the language that's in the president's budget that has just come up here that would have these funds in the hands of the Defense Department. They have not talked with us much about the need, the past need for training and retraining of their leadership, but I feel strongly about it. We need to have our military moving us down that direction or that pathway, and indeed, this is only going to be over a couple of year period. If we find a big problem between now and marking up the 2010 bill, then let's do it then. Let's deal with the 2009 circumstance today. The administration has sent it up. That's the vote today on this supplemental. It seems to me the perfection ought to be that we'll leave it as the administration would have it.
I assume the gentleman wanted the reading suspended.
I certainly did.
Okay. Let me just take a moment to respond, and we'll try to get to the vote after I call on Mr. Murtha. All I can say is that gentleman from California points to IMET. IMET is already running through the State Department, so I think there's an inconsistency in his argument. Secondly, this arrangement of providing the money directly to defense, in my view, is a leftover from the Rumsfeld era when he was grabbing everything that wasn't tied down. And it's about time, I think, that we return to the rational relationships between the agencies. Thirdly, I would point out that in a government like Pakistan, it is critically important to recognize symbols, and it is an important symbol to demonstrate that you have civilian leadership of the military. And and that is why it's important to have the primacy of the Secretary of State recognized, even though this will be a direct pass-through, and it will, in fact, be run by the Defense Department, but it is under the authority of the Secretary of State. That should be understood by people in the greatest democracy in the world, the United States. Lastly, I'm simply doing what I was asked to do when Admiral Mullen called and asked me if I would consider this as an alternative to what's in the underlying bill. We're simply taking the proposal that Mr. Gates suggested as a compromise, and I would urge members to reject Mr. Lewis's amendment and support my amendment, that I would call on Mr. Murtha before giving Mr. Lewis 1 minute to close.
Yeah, we funded this for years in the Defense Department, and as long as we have troops on the ground, I agree completely. Mr. Lewis brought this up in a subcommittee, and I think this is a legitimate compromise. I think we're moving in the right direction. I think we have to send signals that the State Department is going to get more involved, and the military can't solve all these problems. And so I support what we're trying to do here. We can always change it next year if it doesn't work. But I'm convinced that, some people worry about the money won't get through. I think we eliminated those concerns. But at any rate, I support what Ms. Lowy and Mr. Obie are trying to do. And I think that signal we send is that the State Department is going to be more involved in these things.
Mr. Lewis, 1 minute to close.
Thanks, Mr. Chairman. You're being more than kind relative to this issue, but it's a very important consideration. The President has sent up a budget with language that has the money in this package in the hands of the Defense Department for any number of reasons. Petraeus supports that position. The Chairman of the Joint Chiefs support that position. The Commander-in-Chief supports that position. And as I understand it, the Ambassador located in the country we're talking about supports that position. If we want to change it in the 10-year, there's time to do that. We're going regular order. We're going to have hearings for the 10 bill. If we get input that has not come to our attention yet, there's time to change. But for now, I would suggest that we not do the work of 010. Let's do the work of 09, which is what this supplemental is about.
I'm sure the President appreciates the gentleman's support and will treasure it always.
Even I agree now on that.
Those in favor of the Lewis Amendment signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no.
No.
I think the noes appear to have it.
Mr. Chairman, I'm reluctant, but I must ask for a roll call vote.
Seconds. Sufficient number. Clerk will call the roll.
Mr. Adderholt. Mr. Adderholt, aye. Mr. Alexander.
Aye.
Mr. Alexander, aye. Mr. Barry. Mr. Bishop. Mr. Bonner. Mr. Bonner, aye. Mr. Boyd. Mr. Boyd, no. Mr. Calvert. Mr. Calvert, aye. Mr. Carter. Mr. Carter, aye. Mr. Chandler. Mr. Chandler, no. Mr. Cole. Mr. Cole, aye. Mr. Crenshaw. Mr. Crenshaw, aye. Mr. Culberson. Mr. Culberson, aye. Mr. Davis. Mr. Davis, no. Ms. DeLauro. Mr. DeLauro, no. Mr. Dix.
No.
Mr. Dix, no. Mr. Edwards.
No.
Mr. Edwards, no. Mrs. Emerson. Mrs. Emerson, aye. Mr. Farr.
No.
Mr. Farr, no. Mr. Fattah.
No.
Mr. Fattah, no. Mr. Frelinghuysen.
Aye.
Mr. Frelinghuysen, aye. Ms. Granger. Ms. Granger, aye. Mr. Hinchy.
No.
Mr. Hinchy, no. Mr. Honda. Mr. Honda, no. Mr. Israel.
No.
Mr. Israel, no. Mr. Jackson.
No.
Mr. Jackson, no. Ms. Kaptur.
No.
Ms. Kaptur, no. Mr. Kennedy.
No.
Mr. Kennedy, no. Ms. Kilpatrick. Ms. Kilpatrick, no. Mr. Kingston.
Aye.
Mr. Kingston, aye. Mr. Kirk.
Aye.
Mr. Kirk, aye. Mr. Latham.
Aye.
Mr. Latham, aye. Mr. Lautrette. Mr. Lautrette, aye. Ms. Lee.
No.
Ms. Lee, no. Mr. Lewis.
Aye.
Mr. Lewis, aye. Mrs. Lowy.
No.
Mrs. Lowy, no. Ms. McCollum.
No.
Ms. McCollum, no. Mr. Mollahan.
No.
Mr. Mollahan, no. Ms. Moran. Mr. Moran, no. Mr. Martha?
No.
Mr. Martha, no. Mr. Obi?
No.
Mr. Obi, no. Mr. Over?
No.
Mr. Over, no. Mr. Pastor?
No.
Mr. Pastor, no. Mr. Price?
No.
Mr. Price, no. Mr. Reberg?
Aye.
Mr. Reberg, aye. Mr. Rodriguez?
No.
Mr. Rodriguez, no. Mr. Rogers?
Aye.
Mr. Rogers, aye. Mr. Rothman?
There will be one more vote.
Mr. Rothman, no. Ms. Roybal Allard?
No.
Ms. Roybal Allard, no. Mr. Rupersberger?
No.
Mr. Rupersberger, no. Mr. Ryan? Mr. Ryan, no. Mr. Salazar?
No.
Mr. Salazar, no. Mr. Schiff?
No.
Mr. Schiff's, no. Mr. Serrano?
No.
Mr. Serrano, no. Mr. Simpson?
Aye.
Mr. Simpson, aye. Mr. Tehart?
Aye.
Mr. Tehart, aye. Mr. Viskoski?
No.
Mr. Viskoski, no. Mr. Womp? Ms. Washerman Schultz?
No.
Ms. Washerman Schultz, no. Mr. Wolf?
Aye.
Mr. Wolf, aye. Mr. Young?
Aye.
Mr. Young, aye. Mr. Bishop? Mr. Bishop, no. The vote is 20.
No, give it to me. Just give me the number. What is the number? 22. What is that?
There are 22 ayes, 36 noes. The amendment's not agreed to. The motion occurs on the OB amendment. Those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no.
No.
The ayes have it. The amendment's adopted. I urge you to go vote. There's only one vote. Please come back right away. We're trying to get out in time for members to catch their planes.